Hey peeps, Jess here, and today I'm gonna tell you all about my top 10 favorite dessert spots in Seattle. Now, note that I said dessert spots, not desserts. That's because making the top 10 dessert video is gonna take me a while, but dessert spots. Spots with really good desserts, maybe unique or a calming ambiance, places you can hang out with your friends over a cake or some bubble tea, that is what we're taking on today. So I've got my top 10 and an honorable mention in alphabetical order because each experience is so unique, they're so different, and some only seat two people. So definitely watch them all to see which one might be right for you. And this video is being done as a supplement to the Intentionalist list. They've been doing really cool Intentionalist lists for giveaways and prizes in the Seattle area. This is not sponsored, we're just doing this because they are cool peeps. I'll put a link down below so you can check it out. So with that, let's get started. Number one, Amandine Bake Shop in Capitol Hill. I've covered Amandine before when I was covering my top macarons in Seattle video. I'll link that up above and down below. But really, Amandine to me is, it's my favorite chill out place in Cap Hill where I can be really quiet and just sit there with my tea and macarons and have a good time. Yeah, I've rarely been there when there's a ton of people. It's just so calming and inviting. And if I need a good cuppa and some macarons that aren't too sweet, that are just like perfectly paired for those teas, that is where I go. But they don't just have a tea menu. They have like a whole menu of goodies. And because they're by Baitè and Sweet Alchemy and Frankie and Joe's, you could build a pretty sweet smorgasbord of stuff. Just pointing that out. Like one little treat you don't get to see very often from them, but I think is just the cutest, is they have these super tiny tiered cakes and they usually have a fruit ganache inside and they are so good. Like they're not the same thing as Deep Sea, which we'll be getting to Deep Sea Sugar and Salt in a bit here, but if you want like that really cute little birthday cake experience, try Amandine. Number two is Beanfish Taiyaki with multiple locations because they're a food truck. So taiyaki, if you've never heard of them before, are these really cute fish-shaped stuffed pancakes from Japan, but they are really tasty and they have so many wonderful fillings. They actually do sweet and savory at Beanfish. But the reason I love Beanfish are their red bean and more classic flavors. Red bean is like the most classic. Learn to love the red bean, it is awesome. It is not what you're thinking if you're used to American and Mexican red beans. Totally different ball game. Sweet, lovely, little savory, really good. And they do actually have a rotating secret menu. They don't always have a secret menu, but when they do, it's often very good. As for where to get Beanfish, I really like their location. It's usually Saturdays at Awajimaya by Daiso. It's got usually the shorter lines, and then you can go explore the ID, which is always a good time, and it's actually near one of the next items on the list. Number three, Deep Sea Sugar and Salt in Georgetown. If you're willing to make the trek to Georgetown, because it is a bit of a trek, you'll be rewarded with some of the best cake in town. They are my favorite for the cream cheese frosting, and they have giant slabs of cake served in what feels like an old schoolhouse, and it's just really fun to sit there with your giant piece of cake and feel like a kid. I think it's even better if you go like one block away and go to Oxbow Park and see the giant cowboy hat and boots. I think that's the best time. My favorite flavors are probably the chocolate salted caramel and the London Fog, but really they're all pretty awesome. I would try as many as you can, but they are super filling. Like half a slice is super filling. And they have been doing flash sales with delivery if you can't get to Georgetown. Those aren't consistent or to be expected, but they are a thing and they're really cool. So watch out for them. They're not a regular thing. I've only really seen them during the pandemic, but hey, they could be back and that'll be awesome. So you should keep out for them on their Instagram because they go really fast. Number four, Hood Famous. Hood Famous is on this list mainly for their cheesecakes, which are wonderful and dense and have flavors like coconut pandan or mango calamansi. Mango calamansi is my favorite, but they are out of stock as I'm filming this. Hopefully they'll be back soon. But the ID location, which is near where Beanfish sets up on Saturdays, is really great for just options. They have ensaymada, they have the young coconut or buko pie. Occasionally they have really cool local Filipino makers, like they have Kasama chocolate from Vancouver, and they have some really fun stuff. It's just a really cool place to have Filipino snacks. And if you like ube, they have ube cookies, they have the ube cheesecake, they are an ube spot in town. And while the Ballard location has more stuff, the ID location kind of has a secret tea menu in that you can generally mix and match teas and syrups. My personal favorite is getting the calamansi chamomile iced tea. Highly recommend it if you like that herbal teeness with a bit of sour. The only downside to Hood Famous is that they fill up super fast. Almost always, like lunchtime, they are packed. So definitely go at off hours or maybe on Thursdays, just so you can get a seat if you want to check it out, but it's very cool. Number 5, hotcakes, with a preference for Cap Hill. So hotcakes, if you haven't been before or don't know about it, is a place that does the lava cakes or hotcakes. They're little chocolate fondant cakes that have a gooey center and a crispy outer chocolate shell, and they're really, really good and fudgy, and they serve them with ice creams and also other goodies, but at the Cap Hill location, they serve them with soft serve if you ask nicely. I really recommend getting it with the seasonals. So like a while back, they had this sheep cheese custard, the milk and honey, and it was a hot cake with sheep cheese in the center, and then it had honeycomb on the ice cream, and oh my goodness, that was so good. If you're a fan of that honeycomb ice cream theme. They have other desserts, they have really good milkshakes, they're giant, makes you feel like a little kid. It's a good time all around. And also unique to their Cap Hill location, though I haven't done it and I want to, is you can actually go and toast s'mores. They have a little campfire and it's super cute. Number 6, Molly Moon's, with a preference for the Columbia City and Cap Hill locations. So Molly Moon's ice cream is the biggest, it's the largest chain. I think they're at 8 or 9 locations now in Seattle. But really, they still, for me, are, you're having a really bad day and you just want some really comforting, soft, fluffy ice cream with a lot of hot fudge. When it was bad in grad school, or I just wanted to have like a really comforting sundae, I would go and get Molly's Favorite, which has salted caramel and malted milk chocolate ice creams, and then also hot fudge, hazelnuts, whipped cream, and a cherry. I can't get the hazelnuts anymore, but I can get everything else, and it's just really lovely. And also the Molly's Flight, which has 13 scoops, is hilarious and absolutely worth doing at least once. I did it, that was an amazing mukbang, would do again, especially in this weather. And while I do cover a lot of ice cream in this video, it's a classic. They're like just that little bit of a twist on their flavors, a little bit of a twist on what they do. And I also really love just how much they care about equity. And Molly Moon has done a whole lot of stuff on that. I've actually got an interview with her from a while back, and she's only continued to expand, so just very cool. Number 7, Shug's Soda Fountain and Ice Cream, Pike Place location. Shug's Pike Place is just the cutest little retro ice cream spot. It is so wonderful. It's straight 1950s, but with really modern music choices. And I love going there because it's always an adventure to see what they're up to. They always have rotating flavors, they have rotating sundaes. They use Lopez Island ice cream, which comes out super fluffy and light and lovely. And then they have the s'more sundae, which gets toasted to order and it is so dang fun. Also, if you ask nicely, they'll make mini versions. If the big ones seem just too intense for you, I would ask for one of those. And also definitely try the ice cream floats. You might be feeling like maybe getting a float isn't exciting enough, but I do feel like the fruit flavored sodas with the ice cream are really lovely and refreshing, especially right now. Number 8, Sweet Alchemy, preference for the Ballard location. Sweet Alchemy actually has a really cool story. I interviewed Lois about it a while back, and they were actually a Häagen-Dazs that became their own thing, and they make their ice cream on site, and that's really cool. But I love the Ballard location, because while it's not the main location that's in the U District, they've taken over the space with Mighty O Donuts, and so they do unique Mighty O Donuts flavors, and you can get donuts in the same spot. How cool is that? And looking at all the ice creams here, what Sweet Alchemy does that's unique against Molly Moon's and Shug's is that they really are quite experimental with delicate flavors. So like they have a Tale of Two Teas, which I believe has matcha and black tea, which is just really cool. And they do like golden milk and a lot of really delicate flavors, more so than the intensity of Molly Moon's with things like granola and malted milk, or even with Shug's and their series of flavors like mojito. So if you're someone who really loves like turmeric and golden milk, but maybe you also want like really, really fudgy ice cream, you go to Sweet Alchemy. They do also have that location, like I mentioned, in Chop House Row in Cap Hill. I haven't been yet because pandemic, but it's in the old Kurt Farm Shop location, so it's gonna be tiny. And so I would go to Ballard to have the full experience. Also, they have really good sundaes, and sometimes they have secret toppings. So definitely ask. They don't always have them, but it's worth finding out. Number 9, Toccata. Toccata is in Finney Ridge, and it is the work of Chef Toccata Chica. If you're into wagashi or traditional Japanese sweets, which are usually sweets made with pounded mochi and white bean and red bean, and sometimes kantan, which is a kind of agar jello, then you are going to want to try Tsukada. There are places in town like Fresh Flowers and Miro Tea who carry the wagashi, but really the most special is to go to the open houses. It's once a month, and you go to the website and see what she has available for the month. It'll be a grab bag, though she sometimes has some extras available for individual purchase. And you go and you get this box and you find out what you get, and it's just always a great time. And Tsukada itself is in a traditional Japanese house, so it's very calming and lovely to be in. And best of all, sometimes you get really lucky and there's tea ceremony. It's about $7, though please tip your tea ceremony master. And it is just really lovely. You'll watch tea ceremony and you'll also get a special wagashi for the tea ceremony that will not be in the open house collection and is always a lovely calming moment. Though really Tsukada's, he's like four if you're crowding things, so don't bring a big group. Like, bring a small group, have a little time. If you wanna try her stuff with more people, I'd recommend going to Miro Tea or Fresh Flowers Finney Ridge, which will have the best selection, or To Go Coffee in the Central District. There are options, just if you want to go have the full like Torionse experience, go with like two people, maybe three. And number 10, last, not least, is Young Tea in the International District. This is my favorite spot for bubble tea. I've been coming here for years. What they do that's unique within Seattle Tea is that it's a tea forward menu. And so Caroline, the owner, is regularly bringing in tea from other parts of China, and it's a rotating tea menu first and a bubble tea menu second. So if you're someone who really wishes that you could taste the tea in your drinks, you should go to Young Tea and try some stuff out, because you may not want to stick to the signature. You may want to try the Assam or the Iron Buddha or one of the oolongs. The Gardenia oolong is so wonderfully floral, definitely worth trying out. My usual favorites, of course, are still the signature and the Assam and the Earl Grey, but you're not gonna go wrong trying any of the teas. They are quite tasty, and I do love getting the honey lemon when I'm having a sore throat day. They do have some seating, I will say, and fill up surprisingly fast, but they are also really fast in getting your orders out, so if it looks kind of crowded, just give it a few minutes, it might be better in like 10-15. And last, what I couldn't include in the intentionalist list, the honorable mention for Lady Yum Pioneer Square. The only reason they're not in the top 10 is that I ran out of space and couldn't make up my mind. Lady Yum Pioneer Square is really adorable if you want to have like that kitsch Marie Antoinette Rococo experience with macarons. This is the place to go. And also, most of Seattle barely knows it's there, so it's usually pretty empty. The only reason I was again including it is that Felicia, their pastry chef, has recently left for the East Coast. I'm so sad, I miss her. And so I don't know what the future of their entremet collection is going to be like. I'm very curious to see what happens next. I do think they'll have someone come in, but maybe not right now because pandemic. When I think of their macarons comparison to Amandine, theirs are, I think of as sweet nostalgic. So like cookie dough, peanut butter, circus cookies, you are definitely going to Lady Yum. They are amazingly good at that. And the Pioneer Square location is so fun. So those are my top 11 dessert spots in Seattle to go try out and have a dessert, and hopefully we can all go visit them once it's safe to do so. Most of them are already open or have recently reopened, and so definitely check to make sure they're open before you go, but it is always good to support our Seattle dessert spots. And let me know in the comments if I should have included someone else, because clearly I missed people. I was having such a hard time making this list, so I know it should be a top 20. I'm curious what you're thinking. And with that, I will catch you next time. Laters! Like, seriously, arguing this list out took hours. I was so upset by having to leave people out. I left out Intrigue. Intrigue! I adore them. I just could not figure out how to explain them as a dessert spot when I really go there to talk and eat chocolate.